Okay, now we've looked at four parables that I grouped under the heading, Jesus Brings the Kingdom. And we looked at four parables that I grouped under the heading, the Kingdom en route to the consummation. And we're now looking at parables that I've grouped under the heading, the consummation of the kingdom. Now last week we looked at the parable of the net. And when we ended, we were looking at the parable of the workers in the vineyard. And I'll finish my thoughts on that parable, and then we'll move on to the parable of the faithful or unfaithful servant. But as I pointed out last week, at the end of Matthew chapter 19, Peter asked what he and the other apostles will have, meaning from verse 21, what they'll receive or what they'll have, what treasures they will have in heaven. Given that they, unlike the rich young man, had left everything to follow Jesus. And Jesus tells Peter that there are indeed treasures in heaven along with eternal life. And then he says in verse 30, he cautions him. He says, but you need to understand something. He says, cautions him in 30 and says, but many who are first will be last and the last first. In other words, the treasures in heaven often will be allocated contrary to human expectations. See, positions of privilege and honor, such as sitting at the Lord's right and left, right? There's an example of preferred positions, sitting at the... These privileges and positions of honor, they will not follow human criteria or expectations for their granting. And the following parable of the workers in the vineyard explains why that is the case. He says, I want you to understand that these allocation of these things, these privileges and these honors that you're asking about, these treasures in heaven, that there will be reversals of expectation and they will not follow always these ideas and human expectations for their granting. And then he tells a parable, you see, that explains why that is the case. Why the allocation of those treasures will sometimes be contrary to expectations. It is the case because the kingdom of heaven is like the situation described in the parable. That is, just as the landowner in the parable is free, meaning he is not unjust to express his generosity as he chooses, by paying a denarius to the workers who didn't labor as long as some others, so God is free, meaning he is not unjust, to express his generosity as he chooses by giving the same or greater privilege or honor to disciples who did not labor as long as some others or as under as difficult conditions. So that's how. Why is this? It's this way because the kingdom of heaven is like the situation in this parable. And so that's what he's doing in telling the parable. And a key to the parable, a key is that when those who were hired first saw that those who were hired last received a denarius, the amount for which those hired first had agreed to work. So I didn't read the parable again. I'm assuming you remember the parable. But you remember, they're here hired first. They agree to work for a denarius. So when they'd be perfectly content to have a denarius. They agreed to work for a denarius. But when they saw that those hired last, when they saw that they received a denarius, they expected to receive more because they had done more work. So that's really central. See, a crucial point is their expectation. That's what they expected when they saw them receive a denarius. And they were angry because they received the same thing. They received a denarius. They're angry because the master did not elevate them above or distinguish them from the other workers based on their extra work. It was their expectation. They got a denarius. I did more work, so I will get more than a denarius. And they were angry with the master. And they accused him of wrongdoing in treating them all that way. And then the master explains that he simply was being generous to those who were hired later and had done nothing wrong, because he can be generous to whomever he wishes. He was simply being generous. And he can be generous to whomever. There is no moral claim on or entitlement to an exercise of generosity. The giver has carte blanche in the exercise of generosity. There is no moral entitlement to or a claim on an exercise of generosity. And his point is that in the eschaton, in the final state, all labor will be rewarded. But God blesses based on generosity and not on human notions of entitlement. So the door is wide open for surprises, for reversals of expectation for which God cannot rightly be criticized. And that's what he wants him to understand. He says, yes, 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 there'll be treasures in heaven, but you need to be aware of the fact that the last will be first and the first last. There will be these reversal of expectations. Things will not always comport with your expectations of entitlement. R.T. France expresses the New Testament scholar, R.T. France expresses the idea this way when he's commenting on chapter 19, verse 30. He says, those whose renunciation has put them at the forefront of the Jesus movement might naturally expect to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, as their question at 18:1 has shown. But there is no such guarantee. Those who have borne the greatest weight of loyal service for the kingdom of heaven cannot assume that their reward will be greater than that of others. In the kingdom of heaven, nobody earns their status even by spectacular renunciation. They may rightly expect a reward, but not necessarily the reward of preeminence. Not necessarily to sit at the right and to sit at the left. The kingdom of heaven, which operates by divine grace rather than by human achievement, is a great leveler. And you say, well, what's going on with this? Why is Jesus saying this? If my understanding of the meaning of this parable is correct, what is Jesus doing and why is he telling them this? And I think Jesus is telling this to disciples because at least some of them were unduly interested in their status in relation to other disciples. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 1, they're interested in who's the greatest in the kingdom. In Matthew chapter 20, verses 20 and 21, James and John, through their mother, they request to sit where? To sit at Jesus' right and his left, you see, which are positions of relative honor. That's understood. Now, Jesus doesn't say, by the way, there are no positions of relative honor. He doesn't say that. He says, instead, to sit at my right hand and my left is not mine to grant, but it's for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father. You see, so they're interested in this. And I think Peter's statement and question in Matthew 19, 27, that likely carries the assumption that they are most worthy of heavenly rewards. And what I think Jesus is doing, he wants them to know that they are unable to secure preeminence in the eternal kingdom because their expectations of who should be elevated are not a reliable guide of who will be elevated. God, in his generosity, may justly honor someone who does not fit their expectations. He may do that. In his generosity, he may justly and properly honor someone who does not fit their expectations, who does not meet their criteria of exaltation or reward. So it's pointless in terms of seeking preeminence to focus on the labor of other disciples as the standard or motivation for your own labor. If what I'm interested in is I'm looking for preeminence in the eschaton, preeminence in the eternal kingdom, then I'm looking at you and saying, okay, you did this, I'm doing more than this because I want to get a larger crown than you. If that is the standard or that is what is motivating, Jesus is undercutting that by telling them. You have no guarantee of that because these things will be allocated based on God's generosity. So you cannot secure preeminent. So why don't you just quit worrying about trying to obtain a larger crown than your brother and leave the rewards to the goodness of God, and you simply go and labor for Jesus? That's what I think he's doing. So that's why he tells that. That's why, how it ties in, how it flows in there. That's my take and what I understand is going on. All right, consummation of the kingdom. We have the net workers in the vineyard, and then we have the faithful or unfaithful servant. And the parable of the faithful or unfaithful servant, this is reported in Matthew and Luke, which may refer to two different occasions. It's not always easy to tell whether these are separate occasions or whether it's just a different account of the same occasions. In both Gospels, however, Matthew and Luke, the parable is addressed to disciples, and it's spoken in the context of Jesus' future coming. Jesus is making a declaration about his future coming, and more specifically, Jesus is urging them to be continually faithful. He's urging them not to lapse in their loyalty because they will not know when to expect him. This is what Jesus is saying when he tells this parable. In fact, in Matthew 24, verse 44, the verse right before the parable, he says, "Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." And Jesus then says, "Who then is the faithful and wise servant whom his master has set over his household to give them their food at the proper time? Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you, he will set him over all his possessions. But if that wicked servant says to himself, 'My master is delayed,' and begins to beat his fellow servants and eats and drinks with drunkards, the master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and put him with the hypocrites. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Now Jesus is preparing his followers, disciples, Christians. He is preparing them for the time following his death. As Arlen Hultgren says in his book on the parables of Jesus, the parable is remarkably clear, and interpreters are generally in agreement about its essential message. The wise or faithful slave or manager will attend to the duties assigned by the master who's temporarily away. That's Christian disciples will be faithful and obedient and serving while Christ is away. Okay? And he says, knowing that in the end, an accounting will take place. If, on the other hand, that person abuses the trust placed in him or her, he or she will suffer severe consequences. Just so, the disciple of Jesus who is wise and faithful will attend to those duties entrusted or face condemnation at the parousia. That's a technical term. It's from Greek. It's the coming. It refers to the return of Jesus, the second coming. He says, will face condemnation at the parousia of the Son of Man. David Wenham says, the general force of the parable is quite clear. The disciples are servants awaiting their Lord's return, the time of which is unknown. The choice is to be prudent and faithful servants, living in obedience, doing what Jesus wants us to do. Okay? The choice is to be prudent and faithful servants, doing the Lord's will and ready for his return at any time, or to be disobedient and dissolute, to fall away. You see, to live like Jesus is not Lord, to live like I'm Lord. To not do what the one I profess who's master, to not live the way he wants me to do. To break trust with him. You see? To be unfaithful to him. He said, Lord's will ready for his return at any time, or be disobedient and dissolute, reckoning on the master's absence. The outcome will be great reward or fearful judgment. R.T. France says, in the present gospel text, the parable is transparently about the disciples' responsibility to be faithful on the job. fulfilling the task allocated by the Lord until such time as the Lord comes. The time of the Lord's absence is to be marked by unfaltering service that can pass scrutiny at whatever moment the Lord should turn up. So this isn't difficult to understand what he's saying. That we as Christians in his absence are to continue to live faithful, loyal, obedient lives. We're not to say the master's away, so now I'm going to do what I want. Because he's away. You see, no, he's coming, and there will be an accounting. That's the point. That's the point of the parable. Now, the fact the master in the parable comes when this wicked servant is living contrary to the master's desires, that he catches him being wicked. You see, that represents the foolish and grave risk the unfaithful incur, given that Jesus may return at any time. You see, a phrase I distinguish from at any moment or at any second. Okay? He can return at any time, but I do not believe he can return at any moment or any second. I'm going to take a little digression on that for a second, okay? Let me explain why I say that. See, the fact God has revealed that certain things will precede the second coming, will precede the return of Christ, which in my opinion, those things include the rise of Antichrist and the accompanying rebellion and deception. You can see this, for example, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10, 1 John 2:18, 1 John 4:3, Revelation chapter 13, Revelation chapter 19, 11 to 21. But the fact that he's revealed that certain things will precede the second coming, that doesn't eliminate the possibility that Jesus may return at any time. You see, that he may return at any time. If time is understood as a short period of time instead of a specific instant or specific moment. Let me read to you how Douglas Moo, New Testament scholar, explains what I'm trying to convey to you. Moo says, within the New Testament, there are indications that suggest that the New Testament authors, the inspired writers, could not have intended to portray the parousia, the return of Jesus, as an event that could happen at any moment, at any second. For, first of all, Jesus in his teaching rather frequently suggests that there will be a delay before his return. Second, and more important, are specific predictions that could not have been fulfilled if Christ had returned immediately after his ascension. So if he'd have done this, these things could not have been fulfilled. Thus, Jesus promises his disciples that they will be his witnesses in Jerusalem and all of Judea and Samaria and unto the ends of the earth. The gospel must be preached to all nations before the end comes. Peter will die a martyr's death as an old man. Paul will preach the gospel in Rome. Now listen, this is important. He says, it is not sufficient to say that all these could have been fulfilled in the first century and therefore represent no barrier to in any moment, any instant, any second, rapture now. See, that doesn't solve the problem. He goes on, he says, for the point is to determine what the statements about the nearness of the parousia, the coming, would have meant to those who first heard them. If the original speakers did not intend, and the original hearers did not understand a particular statement to require an any moment, any instant interpretation, that statement can hardly have such a meaning now. You see, if when they said it, they couldn't have meant that, well, then it doesn't matter if you say, well, things have changed now. By now, those conditions could have been met. But that's not the point. The point is, what did they mean when they said them? He finishes, he says, therefore, it does not appear that the imminence of the return of Christ can be understood in an any moment sense. It is better to define imminency as the possibility of Jesus coming for his people at any time. Time being understood broadly as a short period of time, it is in light of that any time coming that the church is called upon to live out its calling. I remember, you know, when I've thought about this in the past, you say, well, can things happen really that quickly? Those of you who lived through the Cold War and saw the fall of the Berlin Wall, do you see how quickly things can happen in this world? All my life, the Soviet Union was this massive, just incredible power, you know, the great bear and all this stuff. But like that. You see, things can happen like that. See, so that's, I think that's something important, the idea. Now see, the story, what he's telling, this parable, it's an encouragement to steadfast faithfulness. And it shows that betraying the master's trust in his absence is as foolish as playing Russian roulette. This is how I look at this. It shows that betraying the master's trust in his absence is as foolish as playing Russian roulette by showing what happens when one's assumption of safety proves false, when the gamble fails. So that's showing the foolishness of playing the game by showing what happens when one's assumption of safety fails, when the gamble doesn't pay off. You see, one who maintains awareness that the gun may fire on any pull of the trigger abstains from the foolish conduct of playing Russian roulette and thus is guaranteed to be spared the tragedy. And that's what he's saying to disciples. You cannot, in my absence, just go ahead and live the way you want because you're not sure when I'm coming back. You see, you're not sure when the round's going to be in which chamber. So it's foolish for you to do that. And that's the point that he's making. Now, awareness of the uncertainty of one's time of death, you see, that also can serve as an encouragement to steadfast faithfulness. As we'll see in the parable in Luke chapter 12 that we're going to look at a bit later, the parable of the rich man. But that awareness, you see, that encouragement to faithfulness cannot substitute for an awareness that the Lord may return at any time. Christians are to live in an expectation. We are to live in an expectation of Jesus' return. Let me quote Moo from a different source. This is his commentary on James. Moo says, with the death and resurrection of Jesus and the pouring out of the Spirit, the last days have been inaugurated. This final age of salvation will find its climax in the return of Christ in glory. But, and here is the crucial point, the length of the age is unknown. Not even Jesus knew how long the last days would last. You see in Mark 13:32. What this means is that the return of Christ as the next event in the salvation historical timetable is from the time of the early church to our own day near or imminent. Every generation of Christians lives or should live with the consciousness that the parousia, the return of Jesus, could occur at any time, and that one needs to make decisions and choose values based on that realization. So it was as true in James's day as it is in ours. We need to be patient and stand firm because the Lord's coming is near. This is the perspective. Robert Schenck, in his book Until the Coming of Messiah and His Kingdom, Robert Schenck, he writes, said a professor of theology whom I know, the apostolic church believed Christ would return in their day. He did not, and they were wrong. Other generations of the church believed that Christ would come in their day, but time proved them all wrong. If we expect Christ to return in our day, time will no doubt prove us wrong. And Schenck continues, not at all. In every generation of the church, all who expected Christ to return in their time were right. And all who did not were wrong, terribly wrong. Christ, the apostles, and the entire New Testament enjoin upon us no other attitude than to expect Jesus to return in our time. Whether he returns in our day is God's responsibility. Whether we expect his return is our responsibility, for which we must give account. Whether he returns in our generation or not, we are wrong if we fail to expect him. In every generation of the church, the Lord is at hand. This is the time frame of the New Testament, including the Revelation. Here's a little diagram I did. This is from a 19th century pastor. It's been cited in a number of commentaries on 1 John and no doubt elsewhere. It's a little diagram of how history was before Christ. History is proceeding toward the end. But since Christ's coming, history proceeds on the edge of the end. You see, it skates on the brink of the end. Any time it can arc over and the consummation occur. So you and I, you see, as we go along, we are always on the brink of the end. That's the concept. That's the picture of the New Testament. And I think it's important, and that's what's being taught here. Now, referring to this parable specifically, Klein Snodgrass says, Christian faith is always faith on tiptoe, looking to that day. Because of that day, living in accord with such anticipation. This is why I think, Sue, we underplay this, and I think it's part of our culture, is because, well, you know, that just seems like pie in the sky. It's been so long. Nobody wants. This is Christianity. You see, this is Christianity. We are living in anticipation of the Lord's return and the consummation. What He inaugurated. We live that way. This fills what we do, this expectation and anticipation. Now, the penalty meted out to the servant who abused the master's trust. This is the disciple who apostatized. This is the disciple who, in the master's absence, decided, hey, what do I care what he wants? He's not here. I'm going to do what I want. And you see that this punishment is horrific, as evidenced both by the description and by the reference to the weeping and gnashing of teeth. See, weeping and gnashing of teeth, as Snodgrass notes, it consistently denotes end time exclusion from the blessings of God. That little phrase and that wording consistently denotes this being shut out. It's hell. You see, it's being shut out of the end time blessings. And that's what you see that is used there. Now, whether this servant's being cut in two or into pieces, there's a debate about how to understand that. Whether that's hyperbole for some kind of severe physical punishment short of death, that's debated. But if it is hyperbole, it only underscores the severity of the judgment. You see, it's not like, well, it's hyperbole, it's not important. No, look at it. This is Jesus talking. And he's saying, look here, we'll cut him in pieces and put him with the hypocrites. This is where he's going to be assigned. Luke uses the phrase unbelievers. That's where this apostate will be. That's where this Christian who in the Lord's absence decided he was going to live for himself and reject Christ's lordship, be unfaithful, live the way he wanted, and his desires and what he wants as the master, I don't care. Well, where's he assigned? He's assigned with the hypocrites. He's assigned with the unbelievers. He's cut out, cut off. Now, some are convinced that the parable is directed more specifically to Christian leaders. See, they think this because of the fact that the servant's responsibility is to care for other servants by seeing that they are fed. But I don't think that's right. I agree with Snodgrass, France, and a number of other people. I think that's just an illustration of fulfilling one's duty. You see, that's just an example of serving. It applies to all Christians in terms of faithfulness and loyalty to Jesus. That we have to be faithful, obedient, serious. In living like He's our master. We don't just say it. Oh yeah, Jesus, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Then I live in a way that my master says I don't want you to live that way. Well, okay, what are you doing then? In the master's absence, I'm thinking I'm getting by with it. I'm not being faithful to Him. And Jesus warns here that that's a dangerous, dangerous thing to be doing. Now, in Luke's account, Luke adds, after the parable, Luke adds in 12:47 and 48, he includes this statement. He says, and that servant who knew his master's will, but did not get ready, or act according to his will receive a severe beating. But the one who did not know and did what deserved the beating will receive a light beating. Everyone to whom much was given, of him much will be required, and from him to whom they entrusted much, they will demand more. You see, having in the parable depicted graphically the severity of the punishment meted out to the servant who abused the master's trust. Okay, having painted this picture of what is in store for that servant who treats the master that way, I think Jesus is here reinforcing the call to steadfastness by driving home a principle that is behind that severity. So here we have the master leaves this servant in charge. Servant is unfaithful, blows the master's will off, doesn't care, and he's just punished horrifically. And what I think he's doing now, he's giving a principle. You see, a principle that is behind that severity. And the principle is the greater one's awareness of the master's will, and the greater the responsibility one has been given, the greater one's culpability, and thus the greater one's punishment. In other words, apostasy, falling away from faith, rejecting Jesus after accepting him. Apostasy is worse than unbelief. You see, that's the point that he's making. Apostasy is worse than unbelief, so it's the gravest of all matters. For a Christian who knows the master's will and who has been entrusted with the master's business to blow the master off is in a more culpable position than the person who did not know the master's will and didn't have this entrusted to him. Here's what Kenneth Bowen and Robert Bowman Jr., they say this in their book, Sense and Nonsense About Heaven and Hell. They say this through their Calvinistic lens. You might pick up those that are tuned into this. We'll see some of their wording here, but no matter. The point stands. He says, non-Christians may be interested to know that the punishment of hell will be especially severe on professing Christians, I would say simply Christians, who belie their profession, apostatize, I would say, by their actions. Jesus' parable of the slave who knew his master's will but ignored it, getting many lashes, makes the point. And I can appeal to someone better. I can appeal to Peter. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20 to 22. For if, after escaping the pollutions of the world by the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are overcome by again becoming entangled in these things, the last state has become worse for them than the first. For it was better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after knowing it to turn from the holy commandment that had been passed on to them. It has happened to them according to the true proverb. A dog returns to its own vomit, and a sow after being washed to wallowing in the mud. You see, this is something, the greater culpability of an apostate relative to an unbeliever, it's illustrated in Luke's words. It's illustrated there by the greater culpability of one servant to another servant. Now you notice he doesn't expressly call the second one a servant, but that's implicit, that's necessary for the parable. But it's done that way, you see. This greater culpability of the apostate to an unbeliever, it's illustrated by comparing one servant to another servant, because only a servant would be accountable to an earthly master. You have to make the unbeliever a servant to bring him in the parable so he's then subject to the master's judgment. Without them both being servants, they couldn't both be subject to the master's judgment. But of course, the fact of the matter is that all mankind is accountable to God and thus his servant in that sense. Right? I mean, isn't God God of all? You see? So what happens here, we have the Christian corresponds. It is the Christian who corresponds to the one to whom much has been given and the one to whom much was entrusted. He is the one who has the greater culpability. And so he just in this statement, so what is he doing? Having given the parable and shown the horrific treatment of the servant who blew off the master, he then gives the principle of what is behind that. And the principle that is behind that horrific treatment is that the one who has greater, knows the master's will, and has more entrusted to him, has greater culpability and therefore has greater punishment. Okay, this is why I feel that's it. Now you see, this implies, by the way, that there are degrees of punishment in hell. Craig Blomberg says, the concept of different punishments for different sins is well anchored in the Old Testament and intertestamental literature. These verses, Luke 12, 47 and 48, rank among the clearest in all the Bible in support of degrees of punishment in hell. I mean, you could look at Matthew chapter 11, verses 21 to 24, where Jesus says it will be more tolerable for Tyre, Sidon, and Sodom in the day of judgment than for Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum. So you already see, I mean, you see this idea, there's something of an adjustment. Robert Peterson, in his book, Hell on Trial, he says, although the Bible does not answer every question we might want to ask about degrees of punishment in hell, the main outlines are clear. Because God is just, he will punish the wicked exactly as they deserve. Unbelievers will suffer gradations of punishment in hell. An important point to remember, however, is that hell will be terrible for each of its occupants. Nevertheless, it will be more terrible for some and most terrible for others. I think there is within Scripture, you see something about gradations and God taking account of these things. And so that's how you see, well, how can somebody who is an apostate, who is assigned with the hypocrites and the unbelievers, meaning cast out, shut out, condemned, how can he be punished more severely? Well, this is taken into account. There is in God, there are gradations of where this happens. All right, long way. So this always happens. I'll get to this one. We'll tee it up, and then we'll carry on, Lord willing, next week. All right, the parable of the 10 virgins. This is the fourth one I have in the consummation of the king. You remember I said that some of these things, I have groups, and I put them in groups, but some you could put in different groups because they overlap sometimes. And I just put them where I thought it was the most, but you may think they fit better elsewhere. But I still hope the grouping is conceptually useful to you. Now, the parable of the 10 virgins, or the parable of the maidens, or the parable of the bridesmaids, just depends on the translation you have. It occurs only in Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 to 13. And it comes immediately after the parable of the faithful or the unfaithful servant, which, as we just saw, that parable urges the disciples to steadfast faithfulness in the Lord's absence in light of the fact of the uncertainty of the time of the Lord's return. And that parable ends, the one we just looked at, it ends with a depiction of the unfaithful servant being severely punished at the time of the master's return. Then this parable begins right on the heels of that one, and it's connected or it's linked to that judgment scene by the opening words, then, or at that time, and we get this. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, "Here is the bridegroom! Come out to meet him!" Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves." And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him. Okay, that's it. Those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered, truly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. See, here Jesus follows that. Now, to get something and understand some of this, the role of the virgins here, the role that they play in the wedding scene, it's not entirely clear. But it seems that they're at the home of the bridegroom, or maybe the bridegroom's family, waiting to go out to meet him so as to provide some kind of lighted escort for him and the wedding party to come to the bridegroom's house. So that seems to be what they're doing. They're there at the bridegroom's house. Their function is to go out, meet the wedding party, and then they will provide this lighted procession that will go back to the groom's house. Now, they may have had an ongoing role inside the house. In other words, after doing this, they may have provided lighting for the wedding party. You just don't know. And in fact, the word translated lamps can also be torches. So it's not clear if we're talking about torches or if we're talking about the classic lamp. It could be either one of those. But this apparently was an assigned role in the wedding. You know, we have weddings and we have roles and things like that. You know, you got flower girl and you got all these different kinds of things. You see, well, this was apparently an understood, culturally understood and assigned role that was a significant social responsibility, one that the families, they properly counted on them to discharge. I mean, this wasn't something you just blew off. So that looks to be what's going on with them. And the girls reported for their assignment, but only five of them brought extra oil. Only five of them brought extra oil, which means that only five of them did what was necessary to be prepared for the groom's late arrival. Only five did what was necessary to be prepared for the groom's late arrival. And when the groom finally arrived, they were ready. They were ready, but the others were not. And their readiness, it resulted in their being included in the feast, whereas the others' lack of readiness resulted in their being excluded. That's the point. Being ready, you don't know when he's coming. He's late, but you are ready despite his being late. And as a consequence of your being ready, you're being faithful. You're living in obedience. When he comes, it's entrance into the feast. Not being ready, exclusion from the feast. See, that's what he's after. The kingdom is analogous to the situation described in the parable. You see, in that only those who are ready to meet Christ when he returns, only those who are ready to meet Christ when he returns will enter into the delight of the consummated kingdom of God. Those who are not ready will be shut out of God's presence. The wording that you see in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9 and 10. I heard that second bell. That's how it rolls. Thanks for coming.